Good evening and welcome to 60 Minutes. Now is an exciting time of the year for thousands of young Australians who've taken the leap from high school to university. And for many of the students, there's the added adventure of moving out of home and into on-campus residential colleges. But as we expose tonight, there's a sinister underbelly to many of these residences, a seedy culture of degrading initiation rituals. The hazing, as it's called, is often dismissed as university tradition or harmless fun. But for the many victims who've been subjected to humiliating bullying and sexual assaults, it's anything but. And what's even worse, the administrators of these colleges, those people responsible for looking after the students, are actually looking the other way. A young man commits suicide. A young woman is raped. Another is traumatised by a week-long ordeal of shocking and degrading initiation rites.
Some of them are completely broken. Some of them drop out of their degrees. Some of them self-harm, and as we've heard, some of them will suicide.
Tonight, we go behind the closed doors of Australia's most prestigious residential colleges and confront those who want to keep their secret rituals hidden from the public eye. Did you specifically say to her, "I have seen naked men, I was forced to watch pornography and people simulating sex"?
Yes.
Aria Kerwin is 18, a bright young Melbourne teenager with her eyes on the prize of life. After high school, she had multiple university offers, allowing her to choose her university and her degree very carefully. It would be Adelaide Uni and a degree in law and biomedical science.
In which students are accepted as mature.
And she and her parents chose her residential college with equal care. It would be St Mark's, expensive and prestigious.
So you felt very comfortable heading off to university, that you were going to a safe place?
Yeah, absolutely.
Couldn't have been further from the reality, could it?
Exactly. It was just a completely different world to what was presented to me and what I expected.
St Mark's claims to support the well-being of each student to enjoy a healthy and happy college experience. Aria's parents, Leanne and Craig, were sold, and 3 weeks ago, they moved her in.
And at the parents' evening, they were talking about it being a nurturing and comfortable environment for the kids to settle in, away from mum and dad. We thought, this feels like a really good place for her to be.
Was there any mention of initiation rituals?
Absolutely not.
No, none at all.
No.
Hazing, bizarre initiation rituals inflicted on first-year arrivals. Most university residential colleges deny their existence. But as you'll see, behind the walls of some of Australia's most prestigious colleges is a toxic culture of drinking, degradation, sexual intimidation and assault.
I'd offer anyone who thinks that hazing is fun the opportunity to read through my email inbox. Explain to me how it's fun for these girls who are too scared to leave their room or to be on the phone at 4 o'clock in the morning with the girl who's been hazed and is so traumatised by it that she's cutting herself and she doesn't know if she can stop. That's not fun.
Shana Bremner is co-author of The Red Zone, a damning new report on hazing in university residential colleges across the country.
If you look at the list of universities where hazing rituals take place, the University of Sydney, Melbourne, Adelaide, Queensland, WA, New South Wales, Newcastle, ANU in Canberra, Macquarie, James Cook and UNE.
Yep.
What's that tell you?
It tells me that it's not a coincidence. It's a huge problem. It's nationwide and it's been going on for decades and it's still going on today.
For Aria Kerwin, the first sign that there was a dark side to St Mark's was the evening of February 17, only her third night in the college. Drunken, older students went on a rampage through the building.
They were, like, blasting, like, megaphone sirens and banging on our doors, telling us to, like, get the fuck up. And we were told that we were fuck-ups. We didn't deserve to be at St. Mark's. And they were all drinking, jeering at us, yelling at us for what was about to happen.
Aria and nearly 100 first years, freshers as they're called, were jammed into St. Mark's tiny pond with older students abusing them.
Put your fucking head under, like, you're not doing it properly, like, put your head under.
The following morning, the freshers were forced to perform a variety of humiliating acts.
I was made to eat a watermelon after, like, four or five other people had already spat into it. We had to crawl through mud, do army drills.
So hang on, so you had to eat a watermelon that other people had deliberately spat on?
Yes. Yeah, it was disgusting. And, you know, I thought about saying no, but the girl was, like, yelling at me saying, like, eat the fucking watermelon.
According to the university, no one is forced to take part. You can opt out at any time.
Not at all. And we were never told that it was optional. It was presented to us as being something that everybody has to be doing.
Did anyone refuse to take part?
There was one boy, he did vomit the night before, but then the next morning he had refused to get up and do running or something of that nature. He was made to wear a dead fish around his neck.
They call it tradition. But tradition isn't torture. These practices, these traditions, they do break kids and they stop them from getting an education, and they need to stop.
For Craig and Leanne, Aria's first phone calls home were disturbing.
When Aria started telling us what had happened, to say we were appalled would be an understatement. We were absolutely disgusted. Our idea of A-Week was the kids getting on a bus and seeing what Adelaide was like.
But what was about to happen to Aria on day four of her ordeal at St. Mark's went to the very heart of the toxic college culture of hazing. Sexual intimidation. Again, with drunken older students commanding the action, the young arrivals were taken on a sex tour of the college.
There were people pretending to have sex on the table, dancing around in underwear, and they had porn playing on the TV, and guys that were butt naked, walking around.
So naked men?
Naked men.
Naked men, you had people simulating sex acts.
Yep.
Watching hardcore porn or?
Hardcore porn, yeah.
How'd that affect you?
It made me upset that that was the environment that they were portraying. It just was completely just a contrast of what I thought college was like, and just pointed out a really dark culture that I wasn't okay with.
Coming up, the secret video of St. Mark's bizarre sex tour.
You were forced to take your top off.
Mm-hmm.
And we confront the college master.
Hello.
That's next on 60 Minutes. Aria Kerwin's account of the hazing she endured at St. Mark's and the degrading sex tour she was confronted with is backed up by video and photographs 60 Minutes has obtained, posted online by St. Mark's students in previous years.
It's not a culture that we bought into. We thought she'd be safe and secure in a nurturing environment, and this is a hostile environment. This is total intimidation.
Have they failed in their duty of care?
Completely. As far as I'm concerned, yes, absolutely. They know this is going on.
On her parents' advice, Aria complained to college authorities, including the woman who's been Master of St. Mark's for 15 years, Rose Olwen. She's also president of University Colleges Australia, representing over 60 residential colleges.
Did you specifically say to her, I have seen naked men, I was forced to watch pornography and people simulating sex?
Yes. She said that she was going to have a conversation with the people involved. But there was nothing about, I'll make sure that's never going to happen again, or I'm so sorry you had to see that. Are you okay?
So just dismissed it.
I think she just thinks it's normal.
I said it's absolute rubbish. And I said it's not good enough at all, and you do not even know how disappointed we are with St. Mark's. I said, I am unbelievably disappointed with how Aria's being treated and the other kids are being treated. It's just not right.
The master here at St Mark's College claims she does not tolerate any form of harassment or intimidation. Yet Rose Olwyn stood by and allowed students like Aria to be traumatised. We have serious allegations of hazing to put to her. The main one being, what right does the college have to confront teenage girls with naked men, hardcore pornography, and simulated sex acts?
The buck stops with the heads of college. To claim that they don't know what's going on is unacceptable. If you don't know what's going on, then you've lost control of your own college.
We repeatedly offered Rose Olwyn the opportunity to answer Aria's charges about the college's toxic culture, but she refused. She also refused to meet with us in person.
Hey Rose. I'm wondering why, when you agreed to sit down for an interview, you've now backed out. Can you come out of your office?
From behind closed doors, the college denied that it had failed to take Aria's complaints seriously. But there was one incident Aria was too ashamed to mention to the master of St Mark's, when she found herself surrounded by drunken men one night.
There was a point where you were forced to take your top off.
Mm-hmm.
How much pressure did you feel to go along with this?
I felt in that situation like there wasn't really an option to say no. Well, like some of us girls were saying, no, we don't want to do that. Like, and I felt so intimidated because they were older, bigger, they'd been drinking. You know, I'm a 5'2", 18-year-old. You know, what am I going to be able to say to them that is going to make them stop? So I just thought, I just need to do it.
Next thing you find yourself standing there in just your bra.
Yeah, and feeling very uncomfortable.
Vulnerable?
Very vulnerable, because, you know, it was day four. I barely know any of these people, and I feel like there was such a potential for that situation to probably go really badly, really quickly.
How in this day and age can such a dangerous and toxic culture exist within a college?
Don't know. It's in our news every day, that the terrible suicides with the young kids in our society through bullying. And that's what it is. It's bullying. It's intimidation.
In what part of society is that all right? If that was happening at school, the people would be expelled. If that was happening in the workplace, you wouldn't have a job. And it's really not okay for anyone to pressure you into doing things like that and to back you into a corner so you feel like you can't really say anything but yes.
Feminists united will never be defeated.
What Aria Kerwin suffered at St Mark's is happening in university residential colleges all over Australia, according to Shana Bremner, the co-author of the Red Zone report.
We worked with a student who, during O Week, was forced down onto all fours as part of a game of truth or dare, and a student stood on her hands while another one stood on her feet, one sat on her back, and they chanted no means yes and yes means anal and closed in closer and closer on her.
And were these male or female students?
These were male students.
And by failing to stamp out hazing and humiliation, colleges are also allowing far more serious crimes to occur.
We still see the same incidences of hazing and abuse occurring time and time again.
It all starts from, from making these concessions for terrible things that go on. You are taught from day one of O Week to just put up with really awful behaviour. And that's how it carries through.
That leads up to the point of you being raped.
Yes.
Kendra Murphy was 19 when she was raped at St Andrew's College, Sydney University, in 2014. She blames the college and the extreme drinking culture it encourages for what happened that terrible night when one of St Andrew's top athletes raped her while she was unconscious and drunk.
I sent messages out to my friends to see what happened, if they knew what happened, and I just got messages back saying, you fucked. And then I got a message from a third year girl who said, hey, I was the one that put you to bed last night. You weren't in a good place. I hate to say this, but I don't think you could have consented to anything. Apparently I was just repeating, I didn't want it, I just want my pillow, please put me to bed. So yeah, that message made it pretty clear that I had been raped. It felt awful that it got to that point and that no one intervened because everyone was too drunk. There's no one looking out for anyone when you're too drunk.
Kendra, young and having just moved to Sydney from a country town, immediately went to St Andrew's College authorities. You reported it to the college very quickly.
Yes.
Was there any physical evidence taken?
No. No, that wasn't even suggested.
Which is the first thing you do when someone says, I've been raped.
Correct.
Incredibly, instead of telling Kendra to go to the police, the college said it would investigate her rape. Where in the real world is someone allowed to take the law into their own hands?
Nowhere. And that's the thing, college is a strange standalone place. It's not the real world. It makes its own rules and it doesn't report to anyone. It doesn't happen in the real world and it shouldn't be allowed to happen in a college.
Coming up, the college's shocking judgment on Kendra's rape.
They're not gonna out him as a rapist or take him to the police.
And Hazing claims a tragic victim.
Had he not gone to St Paul's College, he'd be alive today.
That's next on 60 Minutes. Kendra Murphy was raped at St Andrew's Residential College, Sydney University. The outrageous insistence by the college to conduct an internal investigation into the rape led nowhere, except weeks of painful interviews for Kendra and her witnesses. And then the college's judgment.
I was sat down by the vice principal and she said that they're really sorry for what happened to me, but the investigation was inconclusive. There wasn't enough evidence to prove either way what happened.
The fact the college felt it could conduct its own criminal investigation, what does it tell you?
It tells me that these places are incredibly dangerous because their primary objective is protecting the institution that has lived for 150 years.
Had he not gone to St Paul's College that night, he'd be alive today.
While Kendra Murphy's case was horrific, Stuart Kelly's was tragic. The 18-year-old took his own life in July 2016. He was the younger brother of Thomas Kelly, who was infamously King Hit and killed in King's Cross in 2012. And when the Kelly family petitioned for lockout laws, Stuart became the face of the campaign.
Australia is an alcoholic. We need to rethink the way we drink.
His parents, Ralph and Kathy, believe that made him a target in a hazing ritual on his first and only night at St Paul's College, Sydney University, which they say led to his suicide.
And when we arrived, he was sitting in the gutter with his head in his hands, got in the car, and began to sob uncontrollably. And we had not seen him cry since Thomas's life support was turned off in the hospital 4 years earlier.
Did he tell you why he was so upset?
It became really apparent very, very quickly that something was catastrophic. And I said to Kathy, we just need to not question him. We need to get him out of here and get him back home.
St Paul's made Stuart sign a disclaimer for O-Week, absolving the college from responsibility. His parents have been told he was restrained by other students with alcohol forced down his throat. But they fear something far more sinister, perhaps even a sexual attack, happened to Stuart.
What did they do to him there that evening that changed him? If Stuart was possibly sexually assaulted that night, that is a crime. So he took his own life, and suicide is not a crime, but what precedes it might just be.
Just as in Kendra Murphy's case, the college conducted its own investigation.
Well, the serious investigation which they carried out was actually carried out by the college's solicitors, who are paid for by the college. So one has to ask, well, if there's a vested interest from a relationship between a solicitor and a client, so, you know, there's a veil of secrecy.
With St Paul's saying the claims are unsubstantiated, the Kellys believe their only chance of getting answers is a coronial inquest. And they hope that will also shine a light on the darkest corners of college hazing culture.
Hazing is violent, it's about drunkenness, it's about bullying, it's about assault. What's good about any of those things? You know, these rituals, which are barbaric, really should be outlawed because they are criminal.
The cases of Stuart Kelly and Kendra Murphy helped spark a major investigation into the toxic culture at university residential colleges. The result, the Broderick Report, took over a year to prepare and cost more than $1 million. It makes a call for cultural renewal at colleges. But for all that, according to critics, its main message is hazing is fun. It didn't even interview Kendra Murphy or take details of her case.
There was no mention of sexual assault and any case studies on that. The only quotes were incredibly positive and like hazing was fun and all that stuff. It was unbelievable, and I think it should be thrown out and stomped on and burnt.
Frankly, the report itself was terrible. It was a total whitewash. And overall, it was presented as a glossy brochure for the colleges. It was presented as an ad. Come to college, you'll have a great time. Hazing is fun.
Do you honestly think things are going to change within the colleges?
I do, actually, yes. Because I've seen that process lead to real results in other institutions.
Michael Spence is Vice Chancellor of Sydney University. Despite the criticism, he believes the Broderick Report, released last November, will spark change. Would you like to have more power over these colleges?
I'd like to make sure that the issue in the colleges is dealt with once and for all. That's why the university has been working with the colleges to bring change. If it doesn't bring change, then from the university's point of view, all options are on the table.
And what does that mean?
If there isn't an end to those practices, then I wouldn't want to see the students of the University of Sydney there.
There are many kids who have just, or students, young adults who have just started in these colleges this past week, and you wonder what's happening to them right now as we speak. Yet there is no duty of care. You know, the colleges are happy to turn a blind eye to rituals of hazing, and when something does happen, they all protect their backs and everything is covered up.
For now, as Kendra Murphy and Aria Kerwin experienced, colleges are a law unto themselves, a place where seemingly real-world rules don't apply or are overlooked. Aria got out of St Mark's in Adelaide. She's now attending university in Melbourne, while Kendra is finishing her degree at Sydney. Neither are at a residential college, and both wish they never had been.
It's this really bizarre, entrenched culture that the colleges will never get rid of. Like, there can be as much reform as you want, but that essence will still be there, and that's what the issue is. I think they should be disbanded.
How has this whole experience left you feeling?
I think angry now that I'm back home. I'm really angry, actually, and I want to see change, especially reading about some of the things that girls and boys as well have gone through at other colleges across the country. There's obviously a trend that's completely unacceptable in 2018, and it needs to stop.
If this story raises issues and you need to speak with someone, you can call Lifeline on 13 11 14. Hello, I'm Allison Langdon. Thanks for watching. To keep up with the latest from 60 Minutes Australia, make sure you subscribe to our channel. You can also download the 9Now app for full episodes and other exclusive 60 Minutes content.